Rock Cigar Corner. First Premier Edition for 2019, January 2019. So we changed up the bumper music a little bit. We're going to talk about something that's on everybody's minds that usually comes up at this time of the year, which is Cigar of the Year. Now, we're not going to dwell on what the Cigar of the Year is as much as we're going to dwell on how they arrive at the Cigar of the Year lists, and not just Cigar Aficionado, which is the one everybody seems to have shoved in their face all the time, but also Cigar Journal, and we'll talk a little bit about some of the other cigar things. I'd really like to thank David Dangley for putting this all together for us, and while he couldn't be here tonight, his contribution is that if you spent $25 or more, or if you're going to spend $25 or more at Thunderbird, we'll gift you a raffle ticket, and the raffle tonight will be a hat, a Zipar cutter, a nice butane lighter, and an ashtray. I believe those are the choices. So, has everybody that spent some money here gotten a ticket? Do you need a ticket?
The ashtray is already off the market, so that's going to be fine.
There you go, Danny.
Thanks, sir.
Why
did you mark it? Did you pee on it?
I marked it.
Yeah, good. That's what you can tell. I live with dogs.
Through each one of those little grooves.
If it's yours, it's been peed on. That's right.
Another interesting thing that David's doing is he discovered Instagram recently. And if you sign up to, or what is it called?
If you follow
David Dangley on Instagram, he will give you, or I'll give you, a free house cigar, and they're very good. They're $10 range cigars.
You know what his username is?
So, his username
is Chef
_ Lajero.
That's right.
Not something that rolls off the tongue, Chef_ Lajero. If you go to that, if you follow that, you will also, according to David, you'll get all the information about what events are coming up, including mine, I hope, and what... Yeah, that's it. Bingo. You found it. And that should have an opportunity to get you another little freebie. Really appreciate everybody showing up tonight, and I'm really wanting to thank Scott again and Nathan for putting together the slide deck and for making it all happen with Nathan's help. We somehow get it from my... Oh, now it's gone off. How do we make it stay on?
You need to change the timeout to something longer.
I can change the timeout.
Yeah, the screen timeout. Change it to like 10, minutes as opposed to 30 seconds.
Screen time.
Turn on. No. Back out of that. There's something else. I'd go to display and brightness. Nope, down. Right there.
Auto lock.
I don't know, is it auto lock? Yeah.
Never.
Just choose never for... And then when you're done, you can switch it back.
So, the interesting... And I'm not sure. I haven't did this. I think I'll do this early on. I also prepared an Excel, old school Excel spreadsheet of the Cigar Aficionado Top 25 Cigars of the Year, the Cigar Journal Top 25 Cigars of the Year, and the Cigar Aficionado Best Buy Cigars. I picked the top 15 because after that they just kind of dog walkers. As a matter of fact, one of the top 15. Best Buys of the Year is called the 724 Hustler Series Dog Walker. Even I put together this list, and I also highlighted all the cigars that we have available at Thunderbird. So it might come in handy for you. It actually gets rid of all the, gee, I gotta look up who made Cigar of the Year, who did what to who, and where's their duplicates. So we'll have this handy that we can share. And it would be an eye chart if I put it up on the TV, so I think it's easier just to let you have a little something to hold on to. You got one there already? There you go. So there's all the cigars of the year. And you'll see the cigars.
Oh, hey, nicely done on showing what you're carrying. I just saw your color coding.
Thank you. If it's Cuban or European, there's some cigars. Actually, the number one cigar for the Cigar Journal is a Rocky Patel cigar that's only available in Europe. You can't get it in America. It's not sold anywhere but Europe.
And there's a Tatuaje as well.
Yes. And there's a few Cubans in there, so I actually put Cuban in there or Europe in there, which would tell you that no matter how hard you look where you go, you're not going to be able to find them in America. The rest of them are pretty much available in America. But
if you were crazy, you could go up to Vancouver and spend lots of money and smoke it.
True enough. Yeah.
That year, what was that one? The Cohiba, the
Mexique,
the Mexique, and I went up there, and it was $60 a stick.
Yeah.
And it wasn't nearly that good. I'm with you, Scottish.
What can I say?
When they're Cuban, do they actually sell them in Cuba, or are they only for export?
No, both.
Both.
They're both.
You can buy all the Cubans you want in Cuba.
Yeah.
Probably the easiest and the least expensive way to do it. There's a lot. Half the European market is Cuban cigars, but it's easier to get them all in Cuba.
I'd say more than
well,
half.
When I was in Dominican Republic and doing the
Crystals,
they don't sell them.
What now?
This is the number 7.
They're only sold.
Which one is that?
It's the,
every country has different.
Cigar aficionado.
Different restrictions.
The JFR
Limited.
Hey, Bob,
do you know off the top of your head if Joe Schmo in Cuba, if Cuba, like if Cohiba or Partagas has cigars that the common Cuban can afford, can buy, is the, you know, the pharmacist in Cuba buying Cuban cigars and spores, is he smoking hand-rolled stuff from the neighborhood? Or
let me put it to you this way.
That's a good point.
A Cuban cigar smoker that doesn't have, and none of them do, tons of money, is going to find the least expensive cigar to be the Cuban cigar. They're not going to be high-end. They're going to be little
cigarillos.
There's very small rolls. There's unknown names.
There's machine names.
There's machine-made. You can get all that in Cuba cheaper than you can get a Nicaraguan cigar in Cuba, or cheaper than you can get a Dominican. So, everything being equal, the Cuban cigar smoker is going to smoke a Cuban cigar, if for no other reason than just because of affordability. They're more affordable in Cuba than the imported cigars.
So you're on the right track. There's the premium tier, and then there's the working class tier, and there's a lot of very affordable.
And so Cohiba and Partagas and H-Up, and they have like
no
commoner level.
No. They're
more localized
brands. Yeah.
They're made by the same hands in the same factory, grown on the same farm.
But
they're
labeled.
They don't bear the logo. They don't bear the brand.
They don't pollute the Cohiba brand. Like Cohiba is cream of the crop, like Padron is here. So they would never put out a budget for a stick.
When I bought mine directly from the farmer.
So Bud's been to Cuba.
That's a good example.
Did you go to Cuba, what was that, last year?
2 years.
Two years.
I want to listen, but I still
2 years
have to
ago
watch,
in
so.
March. I went.
How was that experience?
And I went to the Cohiba farm and bought my cigars directly from the farmer, because he was able to keep 10% of his crop, which then Cohiba rolled for him and he could sell them for whatever he wanted.
Oh, fun.
Now, they were $24 in the cigar store.
Yeah.
And I bought them for $12.
Oh, that's much, much better. Yeah. So, and it's fun to...
And that was the Esplendido.
And it's, oh, wow. So that's a high-end stick.
Yeah.
And it's neat. You get to deal right with the farmer out on his farm. That's, that makes it special. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that they... I think the Esplendido is about $40 in Vancouver.
Yeah.
Easily. Mm-hmm. I think I paid 70.
Really?
Yeah. Those Bajikas were $60.
Yeah. But if you buy them in any cigar store, those are all government controlled.
Also, the methods used to roll the cheaper ones, like, you know, the leaf that we get in these, they're either done in a tubular fashion or they're done individually as tubes. But they'll do something on the cheaper ones, they do a sandwich where it's kind of like an accordion fold of the leaf. Cheaper ways of making a decent stick.
And the sandwich will take one or two whole leaves and a bunch of scraps.
Right.
A Cuban sandwich is a combination.
So
it's
kind of a mix, kind of a long leaf, short leaf kind of deal. It doesn't mean it's bad leaf, it just means it's not long leaf. Like when we were in that first factory on Friday, and they were carrying trays of leaves, but they were all kind of shredded up, and they were making those into, and it's good leaf, it's just scraps, and they're rolling them into cheaper, more affordable sticks with names you wouldn't recognize, but hitting a price point.
I usually use the scraps for like Cinderella and stuff.
Well, mixed fill.
Well,
a lot of the cigars we have on
for
our
starters.
Oh,
down in Esteli, they sweep up everything. And the place is immaculate. And I said, oh, do you compost that stuff? Oh, hell no. We sell it to the cigarette guys. So everything gets used.
So, as I said earlier, it's that time of year again. Cigar aficionado number one cigar of the year was an E.P. Carrillo. I think it's called the Encore, and I haven't seen it or tasted it yet, so it's probably going to be hard to get. But what I want to talk about is cigar aficionado, how they arrive at the cigar of the year in their list, Cigar Journal, and everyone else, which is literally everyone else. I don't know if you're familiar with the Cigar Vixen, Felicia, but she picked the High Clare Castle, which is a Nick Melillo stick, and she thought that was her favorite of the year, so she picked her top five. The Two Guys Cigar Shop out in New Hampshire picked the Aganorsa Leaf Connecticut, and that was out of their, they claim their customers pick them, and they claim it's only cigars that were released this year, so, and they've been doing it longer than Cigar Aficionado's been doing. But they have eight contenders, and they pick those eight contenders from their own shop. So it's hard to tell how objective all these best cigars are. Is it best because it sold the most? Is it best because it tastes the best? Is it best because it costs the most? I'd want to kind of dig into that because there's so many misconceptions about what makes a cigar the cigar of the year. The first thing I'd like to get into is some of the myths and misconceptions about Cigar of the Year. There's a lot of people that think that Cigar Aficionado, for instance, picks the cigar of the year because they got a lot of advertising money from it. Not the case, and I'll explain that. And it helps to understand how the ratings are compiled and the huge amount of work involved before judging how to best use them. So let me get into the Cigar Aficionado.
No, journal.
Oh, I'm going to do Cigar Journal first. Okay. Okay, let's talk about Cigar Journal. Because this is very convoluted and very confusing. First of all, Cigar Journal is published out of Vienna, I think, Germany, Vienna, Austria. It publishes worldwide. It has 70 different blind tasters that test cigars all year. And every month when they have a cigar journal magazine like this one that comes out, they have a large number, 50 or 60 cigars, that they review and they grade by these 70 blind taste testers. These 70 blind taste testers can't talk with anyone else that's testing. They don't see anything but a number on the cigar. They have no way of knowing what the cigar is. They have a list so long it takes an hour to fill it out of all the different parameters that they're noting on the cigar. They actually have to diligently do homework to grade the cigar. Now, those 70 cigar graders are grading cigars all year long. They grade the cigars separate from Cigar of the Year. None of those cigars that they grade are picked for Cigar of the Year for one simple reason. They don't know what they are. The only people that know what those cigars are back at on the staff at the publishing company at Cigar Trophy. To make it even more complicated, the Cigar Trophy is a separate thing from the Best Cigar List, and the Cigar Trophy of the Year is determined by subscribers. If you subscribe to this magazine, you get an email and you get a mailing every year saying two things. One, a whole series mid-year about who do you want to nominate for the best cigar brand from the different countries. What do you think the best cigar brand is from Cuba, from Nicaragua, from Dominican Republic, from the United States, from Honduras? They actually ask you to nominate your favorite cigar. And then they actually ask you to nominate best value, well, and the best cigar. So they put all of these questionnaires out to the readers, the consumers, the cigar smokers, people like you and I, and they ask them to nominate cigars and cigar brands. Then, after those nominations are placed, they take another couple of months and they pick the top 5 or 10 or whatever from each country. So they'll have a list of nominees from Cuba, a list of nominees from Dominican Republic, a list of nominees from Nicaragua. Then they'll go back to the consumers, the readers again, and say, okay, which is your favorite? Which do you like the best? Those people send all their opinions in. Keep in mind, these are not the same people that grade cigars all year long. They have nothing to do with it. They don't even get this thing. It's just the subscribers, the consumers, the people that smoke cigars. So, the Cigar Trophy Awards are by country, and the top cigar list is a 25 top cigar list, which I'll get to in a minute, but it's an entirely different process. So the best brand from Cuba this year, judged by the readers of Cigar Journal magazine, was the Bolivar. The best brand from the Dominican Republic was the Davidoff Winston Churchill Late Hour. They're calling that a brand. The best brand from Honduras was the Alec Bradley Prensado Lost Art. The best brand from Nicaragua was the Perdomo Reserve 10th Anniversary Connecticut. So people that read Cigar Journal regularly thought the best cigar in Nicaragua this year was a Perdomo, Connecticut. Wow, amazing. But that's how the votes went, and yeah. Did you vote? The best cigar from the USA was Cornelius and Anthony Cornelius. I think that's actually made in Miami. Oh, the best cigar brand, I'm sorry. Now, where it gets even more confusing is they also ask for what cigar do you like the best. The only thing I can tell that's different is that they're asking for what size you want, what particular blend. In this case, the Cuban best cigar was a Monte Cristo 80th anniversary. The best Dominican Republic cigar was La Flor Dominicana La Volcada. So while the Winston Churchill Late Hour got the best brand, La Flor Dominicana La Volcada, the best cigar. And these are Cigar Trophy Awards. The Placencia Cosecha 146 Toro, got it for Honduras. And I think of Placencia as Nicaragua. Placencia also has a huge factory in Honduras, so that's where this came from.
Factories in five different countries.
Yeah. Nicaragua, the best cigar, was the Padron 1964 Anniversary Series Presidente Maduro. Now you say, well, that's been around forever. The Presidente Maduro just came out last year. It's the first box pressed in a metal tube cigar that Padron has made. So it qualified under Cigar Journal to be in the Cigar Trophy Awards. I'm confused. I don't know about you guys, but those cigars are the Cigar Trophy Award winners from the consumers that smoke cigars, totally their opinions one-on-one with a one-on-one vote. Now, there's another list that Cigar Journal puts out, and that's the list I shared with y'all of top 25 cigars. And here's how they do that. They go to their 70 tasters that I was talking about earlier that test cigars all year long. These are people in the industry. These are people that own cigar shops. They're people that blend. They're people that know cigars inside and out, and they smoke every day. And they ask them simple, flat out, easy question. What's your favorite cigar? And those 70 people come back and say, my favorite cigar is. And that's how they determine the top 25 list. Plain and simple. Now, think about it. Knowing that that list is the same people that do the blind taste testing, they don't know what they tested. All they know is what they buy every day, and what they smoke, and what they think is the best cigar that came out in 2018, or that they actually fudge a little and say in the last 2 years. But that top 25 list for Cigar Journal is done by independent taste testers who anonymously test all year long for Cigar Journal. So when they pick their favorite stick, they don't know if they've ever tested it all year. It could just be a stick that never got tested, that never got checked. Oh, a little side note. There's a lot of people that think that the Cigar of the Year list is bought and sold, say in Cigar Aficionado, because of advertising. Well, the people that test at Cigar Aficionado, and I'll get to that in a minute, they don't know what they're testing. So the advertising, they can never make that connection. At Cigar Journal, if you want to have your cigar tested, you have to send a box free to the Cigar Journal and solicit testing.
In fact, it's more than one box. You got to send enough for 70 people.
Yeah.
So three or four boxes.
Yeah.
So on this Cigar Journal.
Yes.
If there are 25 here and there are only 70 people testing.
Yes.
Some of those only might get one. How do they prioritize them?
I don't know how big the questionnaire is. They may be asking on that questionnaire, "What's your top five cigars this year?" Somebody may have answered and said, I love the Padron 26, and that's been out for 20 years, so they scratched that off the list. They have plenty of fodder from 20 individuals to put together a prioritized list of 25 cigars. Yeah.
It's a good question, Bud, because how does 70 people who are literally spread out around the globe end up with the number four stick being the Drew Estate Happy Van Winkle? I mean, that's a fairly obscure stick. And how the hell did it get number four out of those 70 people? So the approach is radically different than CA, as you see. It's much more amateurish in a way.
I mean, it's possible
there's no science
behind. Some of those only got one.
Right, as where the CA ones, you'll see, are the result of a year of testing, cull off the top 25, and then they smoke them again, blind. So it's very scientific. This one is very casual, in a way. It's just like a brotherhood.
Now, knowing that, it would be
informed, as opposed to the staffers in the office compared to the readers. Three groups that get to informally say what they like.
Every list, what would be the miracle is if every list actually was identical to every other list, because this is such an off-the-wall, loosey-goosey type of questionnaire that even if you ask these same 70 people 2 months later, you might get a whole different list.
It's more of conducting it in a cigar lounge and just having a show of hands. It's much more casual.
Two little quick summaries about Cigar Journal. One, the Cigar Trophy Awards are separate from the Best 25 list. Totally separate. The Cigar Trophy Awards are determined by consumers like us. It's our favorite cigars that we bought and smoked over the years. So there's a pretty good perspective of a democratic vote of what was the best on the Cigar Trophy list. On the top 25 list, it's people in the profession who like a certain cigar the most. It has nothing to do with the cigars they review every month. Absolutely no connection.
Are the goals of the two magazines similar?
Well, to sell cigars to people, good question. How does advertising work with cigar? And here's this is Nathan's favorite phrase to me that I hear him say more than once is follow the money, okay? We're gonna follow the money. Cigar Trophy Awards also has some awards that they pick in-house. The staff actually picks them. One of the ones they pick is the best accessory, okay? And the best accessory was the perfect draw, which is my favorite accessory. You've all seen it. It's that thing that I poke cigars with. The perfect draw won best accessory, and guess what is in this month's issue? Cigar Journal magazine. I can't find it right now. A full page ad from the owner of Perfect Draw saying, "Thank you, Cigar Journal, for making me the best accessory in 2018. So he got paid for a full page ad the same month that the award came out. There's also full page ads for the best cigar lounge, Lifetime Achievement, which went to Carlos Fuente Jr., and all these best cigars. When you follow the money comes after the fact, not before. So when you think of in cigar aficionado, they bought all this advertising for the last 5 years, so they gave them a tip of the hat, gave award. No. It's after the awards are given, the companies that receive those awards run to the magazines to get their brand in front of everybody that reads these lists to say, "I'm the best. Look at me." This guy's a dentist in Florida that made the accessory of the year, and God knows how many thousands of dollars he's just spent to put a one-page ad in Cigar Journal worldwide, all over Europe, all over everywhere, to say, "I'm the best." That came after the award, not before. So the thing that was kind of an aha moment as I was studying all this stuff is the money follows the awards. It doesn't receive the award, but the money does in fact take place. One, when Scott brought up the fact that, and we saw it firsthand, that if you want your cigar to be reviewed in Cigar Journal, you got to send 3 cigars. That's not so, and I'll get into that in Cigar Aficionado. They eliminate that possibility because of experience. And two, the money comes after the award, not before. Yeah, Dan.
Yeah, Bob, I had a question.
Sure.
So, I talked about advertising. Actually, a bunch of neat geeks and nerds like us that, you know, like cigars. Besides magazines, is the bulk of cigar, or let me rephrase, is the bulk of cigar advertising in those two journals, Cigar Aficionado and Cigar Journal? Because, you know, in today's day and age of social media, I mean, magazines are pretty primitive, and you don't see Facebook ads of cigars or YouTube ads of cigars or TV ads, much less so. Aside from word of mouth, guys like us and gals like, you know, how does the cigar world advertise?
All right, good point. And I'll challenge you. I want you to think of yourself as a cigar company owner. You own a cigar company, and you have X amount of dollars. You're making a profit, but you'd like to make more, and you're not getting enough, and you want to make more money. So you're going to spend that advertising dollar where it gets you the biggest return. Now, historically, spending advertising money for your company has gotten you pretty good response and returns from cigar shops because of Cigar Aficionado magazine. And more recently, you may have noticed that Cigar Journal advertising has gotten you some response. So you go to your spreadsheet and you go to your account and you look at all this stuff and you say, where's the most activity from consumers on our marketing efforts? Oh, well, we're getting 18% from Cigar Aficionado, where we get feedback. We're getting 12% from Cigar Journal, but we're getting 67% from the internet. Oh, really? Tell me more about this internet stuff. Oh, now, if you go to Cigar Snob magazine, on the back page of the magazine, they list all of the, they list Instagram, they list Facebook, they list websites, they list all the different Twitters and things, and they show which companies got the most hits. So much so that cigar companies, because that's such a big influence, have gone to accounts and bought like fake 10,000 or 100,000 hits and put them on their site, and they're fake. There's counterfeit hits in the web. So it's shifting, it's changing tremendously. There's a lot of old farts out there that have traditionally gotten a magazine and went, oh, I gotta have that. Oh, look. As a matter of fact, today I was reading a magazine and I just found out that the Oliva, the Cornelius Oliva, the real cheap one, it's in a natural, and it's in a Connecticut shade. Right now, it's coming out with the Maduro. I can't wait to get my hands on it. When I see that, I saw it in a magazine. What do I see when I go to the internet? Nothing. It drives me nuts. I want to throw the wall against the phone, because when I press this and swipe that, it all goes back to, you know, do you want to see Jane? Do you want to see my pictures? I don't know what I'm doing on it. But the younger people, my point is it's changing dramatically. And people are starting to take account of how much influence the internet and virtual marketing, and what kind of virtual marketing is worth putting your money and your efforts into. And is it worth sending reps? Okay, there's a company that sells all the cigars they ever want to make called Padron. They don't have a single representative that ever goes to a single cigar store and ever sells a single cigar. Ever, ever, ever. They don't have it. They don't need it. Perdomo, my father, have people that live on airplanes and hotels. All they do is go to the cigar store, because that point of contact, that word of mouth, and that cigar store is where their accountants told them they got the most bang for the buck. When they had events, when they visited a cigar store, sales went up. So they said, you know, if we buy one airplane ticket and pay Jose Ortega's salary and rent him a car and buy him a hotel, we make $700,000 in that town. Keep sending him, don't let Jose ever go home. Don't even tell him where his house is. Keep him on the road. Keep him selling stuff. So it all comes down to following the money, you know, and that is changing drastically. It's changing from printed material, not just in the cigar industry, it's changing from printed material to, yes, now, I've got Cigar, and I'm a subscriber, I got Cigar Journal, and I had to go to the internet to find out what the top 25 cigars of Cigar Journal were, because it's not in the magazine yet. All they had was a cigar trophy. I got to wait a month, and I've got to wait until Cigar Snob comes to my house, because their list isn't out yet. It's coming out tomorrow. so I don't have a top five.
But if you were going to go to the internet and you wanted that Maduro, believe it, Maduro.
Yeah.
Oftentimes when they show that, they show the top part and they have ads.
Oh, yeah.
At the top.
Or down the side.
Yeah. Won't you find that?
Yep.
There are ads that way.
There are ads that way, but those ads come from internet cigar stores like CI, cigar.com. And the next thing I touch is asking me to pay for something. So, yeah, there's direct sales on the internet, and they ship it to you. And that's half the business right now. That's the growing half.
It's a guy we met down in Esteli.
So,
in one of his sticks ended up in the top 25.
This is something that
Man Maduro.
That we talked about earlier. Just wanted to emphasize that the 70 testers who test cigars all year, month in and month out, which is not part of the top 25 list, is very diligent. It takes a long time. It takes a lot of work. And cigar companies actually submit their boxes. But the testers never know what they're smoking. They don't have a clue. They can try and guess, but they have no idea, and they don't get told later. Talk about the Cigar Trophy Awards.
I want to add something for Danny. It's been fun smoking cigars for a number of years and seeing the media change from where it was just magazines to the internet. And the most powerful thing that I've seen so far is word of mouth combined with social media. And you've heard us talk about Romacraft.
Yes.
And his factory is...
Romacraft is the one that makes Guamaro, right?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, okay. So
you got him. You had him at Guamaro.
His factory is the size of this lounge, and that's it. And he's got a dozen rollers, rolling pairs. It's a very modest. And he does about 1.3 million sticks a year, sells them all.
1.3 million.
So the New York Times does a big article last year on the cigar industry, and they talk about the big heavyweights, Padron and Fuente, and then they have a paragraph on Romacraft, who compared to those guys, he's nothing. But they said Skip Martin, who uses Facebook every day, he posts something to his fans, and they said this guy's got a cult following. Hardcore, dedicated enthusiasts, because he has used social media and the word of mouth to drive this intensity.
Yeah.
And so that's how it's changing. And the magazines are behind the curve. And Padron doesn't have reps, but they have a 2-page color fancy spread every month, like clockwork. So they're old school, but the sharp guys like this Nick Melillo, who does that Tabernacle stick, he placed in the top 25, and he doesn't own a factory. He only owns the brands and the blends and the artwork, and he's social media king, and he's number 3 in CA, which is like going to watch the ponies at the racetrack, and a horse comes out of nowhere and scores. And you're like, who the hell's this?
Right.
It's the power of social media and word of mouth.
And you mentioned Romacraft, the guy that's at the front right now.
Yeah.
I asked him about it because Bob had told me that Romacraft is the one that makes Guamaro.
Right.
I asked him if there was anywhere I could find it. And he said, the is the other one Smokey something?
Smokey Joe's.
Right. So I went up there about a week ago, and they didn't have it. But on a side note, I didn't too much like the environment there. I felt too much like I was at a sports bar.
It is a sports bar.
It's
advertised as a sports bar. I didn't go there for a year when I first learned of it. A lounge I haven't been to. Oh, it's a sports bar. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know that, and I mean, I liked it so much here, I just never bothered to go. It's closer, but I thought I might be able to find the Guamaro there.
No.
I got one other thing, and I apologize. I got off on because I'm so excited about what we've learned about Cigars of the Year. But the number two Cigar of the Year was the La Opulencia by my father, which a year ago I said this ought to be Cigar of the Year. Well, it got to be number two, so I can't say. That's as close as I'm ever going to get.
He's pretty good at picking the ponies.
David likes us to enjoy a good cigar, and David contributed the number two Cigar of the Year, which may be very hard to get in another month or so, for all of us to have a sample of tonight. So, there you go. I was bucking for...
You know where to buy the Guayamaro, right?
Online?
That's it.
I think it was Thompson or Famous.
Yes, you do.
Absolutely.
Did
you get one?
No. Santa Claus dropped a box of Guayamaro off of Raisins. He knows where to buy it.
I hope we're not using up all of Nathan's phone memory here, so I'm going to try and get into cigar aficionado.
I don't know. The environment was too fast. You know, if I want to go to a sports bar, I'll go to a sports bar. You know, I like the lounge feel here.
We've come to love that place. We've spent a lot of time there.
Smokies?
Yeah. We've been hanging out there for years now.
What bothered me was the cigars on the walls in front of the TV. So you have to walk in front of people. It's kind of awkward.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody's watching the game and you're kind of standing there.
This is the only one that's on both lists.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. It's got pros and cons, just like here. Every place has got pros and cons.
But I did notice that.